are here to hear our first talk in the block is from Ray, who will be telling us about remixing the layer cake, facilitating fan reinterpretation in Caves of Qud's data files. Ray studies math and computer science. When they're not dreaming about Caves of Qud, they might be found playing it instead. It's like goals, truly. Ray, welcome to the celebration.
Hi, thank you for coming to my talk. As Christy said, this is Remixing the Layer Cake, facilitating fan reinterpretation through Caves of Qud's data files. Well, if you haven't heard of Caves of Qud, a possibility. It is a science fantasy RPG and roguelike epic that is finally releasing in 2024. There's a lot I could say about it, but what I'm specifically going to be talking about is how it presents a broadly inspectable and extensible engine. Manipulating the game comes in about three different aspects, depending on how you count. There's like data files, C-sharp scripting that sort of conforms to the interface that the game provides. And then for the very precise things that you need to do, the game allows you to sort of directly patch over. But I'm focusing on the data files specifically. The data files in Caves of Qud are primarily XML. So I would provide an example, but if you saw Mike Cook's talk yesterday, it had an example of what you might see here. There's a little bit of JSON, but that doesn't come with the same functionality. But the data files are generally end up being like lists of like defining specific items, such as like objects, etc. And the important part is that items sort of can inherit. There's an inheritance tree of sort of properties and aspects. You can also mix in things for objects. I'm not going to touch on that, but the really important part for modding is that you can merge your part that you define over. You can sort of like overlay it and sort of specifically rewrite precise parts of the data tree. And another important aspect of this system is that there are escape hatches to scripting for functionality. It's mostly considered parts, but you can attach these sort of you can attach these parts to specific objects, and then they provide that action or whatever the part does. There's a lot that's defined in data files in Caves of Qud, including game objects, so items and creatures, and conversations, quests, population tables, which are like what the game uses to pick randomly for like picking random items and such, or even like factions, books, and then even more precise things such as player presets. There's even options to define your own custom genders and pronouns, which I find pretty fun. So what does this get us? Specifically, as a modder and somebody who works on the wiki, I argue that the system provides a strong capacity for reinterpretation, which I'm defining here as like the ability for players to parse, reuse, and transform a game's data. For the wiki, that works as basically like taking a game's, like the game's data files and moving that data to the wiki. So the specific pipeline is that we take the data files, it goes through a program called Hegedus, not quite sure how to pronounce it, but to sort of parse out specifically the game objects. And then we upload them to the wiki through another program called the Qud blueprint explorer typo. This makes keeping the game content on the wiki updated much more. It makes it much more easy to keep it updated. Because all you got, like the program will like find where like objects need to be updated, and you can just upload them from there. Because we transform it through this process, on the wiki we use Media Wiki, which is the wiki software, a feature called cargo tables, which basically lets us use the data on the wiki in sort of like a database style, which allows searching and filtering and relating items together in ways that are not static. A complication for this process is that like what is convenient for a game ontology, so like what a game considers each individual item, is not necessarily how it works for for a wiki. So like there are three different doors that need different keys to unlock in the progression of the game. Does it make sense for us to make each of these a separate page? There's also like there's like an entire sheet of like here are like the overrides that we do, which it's very convenient and it ameliorates a lot of the work, but it's still like all of this still requires work. Like having an effective wiki still requires work on the behalf of the wiki team, which in the Qud community are called the trash monks. So writing user presented prose, making sure that all the things that we can't upload through this process are updated and so on. Like it still requires work. So it's very convenient. Still, like it doesn't completely remove the user's, like the game player's involvement with the system. For modding, I would argue that this framework is very useful for modding because it is significantly more robust towards interface and game changes than strictly scripting. It also allows for small changes to be only a couple lines of code. For instance, like my favorite example of a short mod is one that there's an item in the game called transkinetic cuffs that makes transkinetic the trans flag colors. That's like more like four lines of code or XML to override that specific property. It also allows for modders to repurpose like the parts that I mentioned earlier. So you can sort of take little bits and reuse them in your own way. If you recall Mike Cook's talk earlier yesterday, he sort of talked about that too. However, like for modding, that's not always the easiest. Because like sometimes the way that parts are conceptualized doesn't work for the mod, like for the changes that you're trying to do. So like the biggest example I can think, like the first example that comes to my mind is that there are rocket powered boots in the game, and the functionality that sort of lets you jump with them and leaves a trail of fire behind, like that is considered one whole part. So if you want to split it up, then you have to dip into C#, which is it's not the end of the world, but it is less convenient. And I think ultimately there's sort of a tension between power and comprehensibility for the system. So like, how much do you want to make it like a programming language before like it is like a basically a programming language. I'd argue that it is a programming language, but it is much simpler than C sharp. But if you want to like do actions based on like what other mods there are, the state of the game, and so on, like those can be more complicated to do than I think is like hypothetically possible. But if you're interested in learning more about the system, all of these links are listed in the README for the code for these slides. Specifically, I would check out the Snapdraw Mages wiki tutorial. It does a really great job of sort of walking through the specific data manipulation required to sort of create your own weapons. And the other thing I'd want to point out is this next weekend, the Discord community for Caves of Qud, me and one of the other community members, Lou, we are running a modding jam for Halloween. If that's the kickstart that you need to get started. Thank you for coming to my talk.
Cool. Thank you so much. This is, gosh, it sounds like so much fun. Monster jam. If you told me 2 days ago, like, I would be excited about XML, you would have surprised me. But now I'm like, oh man, that actually sounds really cool.
Yeah, XML is not the easiest to write, but I think it is useful in this context.
Totally. Okay, we have one question from the chat, which is, can you explain more about what you mean by ontology?
Okay, so by ontology, I'm using it as sort of a broad word to mean like how the game understands what is a thing. So like in the example, like each of the different doors is its own object defined in the game. The game refers to them as blueprints, but is that necessarily what we want when presenting it as a concept to the user who might sort of conceptualize those as like, oh, these are the three different doors, each of which require, like, because you go through them in sequence. So basically I'm talking about like, how does the game conceptualize itself in like what's considered an object, what even like possible categories of things there are. So like that list that I listed, all the things that are defined in data, like what is like defining those, all of that. I'm not sure if that makes sense.
I think so. So let me see if I got this right. So you'd be like, okay, I want to modify the fire that comes off the rocket boots. I actually need to modify the rocket boots because that is the one thing altogether.
Yeah, basically. So like what the game considers discrete.
Yeah.
Versus like the same thing.